MacLeod music comes from a presentation made at the Clan MacLeod Auckland Gathering in 2013. The three performers from 2013 are again entertaining us, and I thank them for their support. All this music has a MacLeod connection. It is written by a MacLeod, about a MacLeod, or about MacLeod lands. The Clan MacLeod has a justifiable pride in their music tradition. Our early chiefs kept musicians as members of their households. Until the late 15th century, the harp was a dominant instrument, but from then, the bagpipes took over. Around 1500, Alistair Craddock, 8th chief of the MacLeods of Harris and Dunvegan, was appointing MacCrimmons of Borrorraig as his personal pipers. Through 10 generations and over 300 years, the MacCrimmons held this position, and their piping school became famous throughout Scotland. In the early 1800s, with the changes in social order in the Highlands and Islands, these MacCrimmons migrated to Canada. Their descendants still play the pipes in their new country, continuing a tradition going back over half a millennium. The MacLeods have produced prominent pipers in contemporary times. Pipe Major Donald MacLeod, MBE, from the Isle of Lewis, was one of the most prolific composers of bagpipe music in the 1900s. A leading piper today is Roddy MacLeod, MBE. Roddy is director of the annual festival Piping Live and principal of the National Piping Centre in Glasgow. The prominence of bagpipes didn't mean other music disappeared. Ian Breck, 18th chief, still kept his personal harpist, Roderick Morrison, the blind harper, who composed and made music until the end of the 17th century. The Rasay MacLeod family were well known for their music and dance that took place in their household. Even the rough black houses of ordinary folk enjoyed song, music and dance. There are many MacLeod musicians around today. They carry forward, in a modern form, a long proud MacLeod music tradition. The instruments, tunes, songs and language may have changed, but the love of music remains. Our first song is Rise and Follow Charlie. Scenes show Bonnie Prince Charlie, the Glenfinnan Monument where he raised his father's standard, Charlie addressing his army and the victorious march south, Culloden Moor where he suffered his defeat on the 16th of April 1746, and an incident in this, his final battle. Video footage shows Prince Charlie's cairn at Lochinvar, the Loch of the Cave, from where he departed for France on the 20th of September 1746. The tune is a traditional Highland air and believed to date back to the early 1700s. The original words were composed later, possibly in the 1760s, and were Oh the Moor Among the Heather. They were printed in 1792. Robbie Burns credited these words to Eugene Glover, who, Burns noted, was remarkable for her beauty of face and figure, and was also an excellent singer. The MacLeod connection comes later, through Mrs. Norman MacLeod, a lady about whom we know nothing. She took the tune and rewrote the lyrics. Rise and Follow Charlie is a good example of a Victorian-era Jacobite song. A century after the rebellion, led by Bonnie Prince Charlie, Scotland became fashionable. The romance of the prince as a charismatic but failed hero who, even in defeat, achieved admiration, struck at the heart of the middle and some of the aristocratic classes in Victorian Britain.
Sound the pibroch loud and high, Free John the Groats to the Isle of Skye. Let all the bands we battle cry, Rise and follow Charlie, Patching on, 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 Patching on.
Oh,
that small devoted Highland band. They swore to fight with heart and hand, and I for Royal Charlie, a chief. Every glen is gathering now the loyal men. They raise their dirks and shout again, hurrah for Royal Charlie, a chief. Dark Culloden's fields of gore, ah, how they fight claymore, claymore. Bravely they fight, can they do more than fight and die for Charlie? All the men that fought and died for Charlie,
and she and so.
The tune Moray of Dunvegan is sung in both Gaelic and English. It is played on the fiddle and also the bagpipes. On screen we have the old Dunvegan road, pictures of Dunvegan Castle and the view across Loch Dunvegan to MacLeod's Tables. The ruins are the old inn, all that is left of the original Dunvegan village, and a black house, a cottage of the type the young man would have built for his Moray. Dunvegan is the centre of the MacLeod world, and Moray a good MacLeod first name, so we can assume Moray just has to be a MacLeod. Moray of Dunvegan was written by Katrina Douglas of Skye, who was born in 1893 and died in 1965. It is supposedly sung by a young man about his love. He says he will never tire of singing her praises. She reminds him of the birds and the flowers. And when he plays his pipes, the music is filled with his love for her. He plans to build a cottage on the shore where they will live after they are married in Dunvegan. But we don't find out if his dreams are fulfilled. At the end, we hear Moray played on the bagpipes by two pipers from the Sydney Clan MacLeod Pipe Band. On screen is the pipe band, an 1815 picture of Dunvegan Castle, and a visual tour of the beautiful gardens.
Praise to my darling Moray. thrones comes magic of chanter tones. Love throbs in my very bones for my darling Morag. Spot where someday we'll build our cot. Oh, happy will be my lot when wedded to my Morag.
Mrs. MacLeod of Rasay is a Scottish reel published by the famous fiddle player Neil Gow in 1809. During our introduction, we will see Chief John of Rasay and Mrs. Liz MacLeod of Rasay leading a MacLeod parade off the Rasay ferry and at Rasay House. Then Rasay House itself and views to Skye. Finally, Chief John and Mrs. MacLeod of Rasay will wave goodbye. Neil Gow said he obtained the reel from a Mr. MacLeod of Rasay, who described it as an original Isle of Skye reel. The MacLeod Laird of Rasay around Gow's time was James, 12th of Rasay, who inherited in 1786, but there is evidence that the tune is older. It was probably composed for James's mother, Jane McQueen, who had married John MacLeod, 11th of Rasay. It was Jane and John of Rasay who hosted Johnson and Boswell at Rasay House in 1773 during their tour of the Hebrides. Johnson wrote, "Our reception exceeded our expectations. We found nothing but civility, elegance and plenty. After the usual refreshments and conversation, the evening came upon us. The carpet was rolled off the floor, the musician called in, and the whole company was invited to dance." Surely one of the tunes played was Mrs. MacLeod of Rasay.
Thank you.
The words "For raving winds around her blowing" were written by Robbie Burns and dedicated to Miss Isabella Rose MacLeod of Rasay. The tune is MacGregor of Rora's Lament and published in 1784. Introductory scenes include Robbie Burns and Edinburgh, an East Indiaman, the type of ship used between Britain and India, Rasay House and views of Rasay. Burns alluded to the feelings of Isabella to her sister Flora, who died in 1780, also to Flora's husband, the Earl of Loudoun, who shot himself because of financial problems a few years later. The Rasay family had a residence in Edinburgh. Robbie Burns was introduced to them by a mutual friend while there. Isabella, a particularly beautiful young woman, attracted Burns' attention and in 1787 inspired him to write a poem of admiration to her. The next year, 1788, Burns wrote Raving Winds Around Her Blowing. Isabella had a sad life. She married Major Thomas Ross and was with him in India. In a battle, Ross suffered exposure, fell ill and died. Isabella, who was pregnant, decided to take her daughter, Eliza, back to England. During the voyage, Isabella's baby girl was born, but Isabella died during childbirth. The boat was met by Isabella's brother James, 12th of Rasay. He was shocked by his sister's death, but took charge of Eliza and the baby, who was named Isabella Rose after her mother. The two girls stayed at Rasay House until they reached school age, then were educated in Edinburgh. Of the Road to the Isles are attributed to the Celtic poet Kenneth MacLeod, and it is said to be written for the lads in France during the Great War. Our views, the Coolans, Loch Tummel, the Tangle or Seaweed, and Loch Mora are all along our walker's route. With the bagpipes we see scenes of the Isle of Lewis, his final destination. The Road to the Isles is part of the Kennedy Fraser collection and appeared in a book, Songs of the Hebrides, published in 1917. Marjorie Kennedy Fraser toured the Hebrides collecting for the book. The tune she found in Barra, although it had been composed by Pipe Major John McLennan of Dunoon and called The Burning Sands of Egypt. Kenneth MacLeod then composed the words we know today. It traces the route of a homecoming soldier as he crosses Scotland. He dreams of the Coolans of Skye as he strides by Tummel, Loch Rannoch, Loch Arbour, Shearwater, Aylward, Mora, and finally to the Lewes, or Isle of Lewis. It is a bright, happy song as he steps with sunlight for his load, and along the way he talks of smelling the tangle, a seaweed of the Isles. Kenneth MacLeod was born in 1871. He was a Church of Scotland minister and folklorist, and died in 1955.
It's the Falklands is pulling me away, as you may be coming for the road. It's the Falklands is putting love for me, as step away we the sunlight form and load. To the sea, it's the cool grasses that take enough for her and heather for a week of mother's knee. Sure, my tunnel.
The MacLeod connection is through the song's composer, the Reverend William MacLeod. Scenes show the River Ouse flowing into Loch Bracadale. There are pictures of Loch Bracadale and then of Campbelltown, the Reverend William's new home. It is a beautiful, melancholy, slow air composed in the 18th century. The Reverend William MacLeod reflected his thoughts as he sailed away from his native Bracadale in the Isle of Skye to take up a parish in Argyll. The Reverend William MacLeod was born around 1717, the third son of Roderick MacLeod, 1st MacLeod of Uilenish. In 1743, Reverend William married Isabella, one of the 29 children of Donald MacLeod of Burneray, the old Trojan. William and Isabella themselves had 17 children. William was ordained to Barra in 1742. From 1749 he was Minister of Bracadale and in 1767 transferred to Campbelltown in Argyllshire. The tune was published in Captain Simon Fraser's Nocky Collection of 1816. Waipu Settlers commemorates an epic voyage of migration and its charismatic leader, the Reverend Norman MacLeod. The words and tune were composed by Catherine Faith Mackey, known as Willow Mackey. She was a New Zealander, born in 1921 and died in December 2006. In the 2006 New Year's Honours, she was awarded the Queen's Service Medal. On screen, we see Waipu Museum, which houses much of the voyage memorabilia, a painting of the Reverend Norman, and two photos of him, the ship Margaret and the site where she was built, the Cape Breton Gaelic College, built on land once owned by Reverend Norman, then a monument dedicated to him at Stour in Scotland. We visit his gravesite in Waipu and nearby countryside. Norman was born in Stour in 1780. His strict scripture interpretations had him fall out with church leaders, but he preached in defiance of them. The clearances and starvation in the Highlands induced Norman to sail for Nova Scotia in 1817. On board, he preached daily and won many admirers. At Pictou, he became the group's leader. Pictou was booming, but Norman considered it unsuitable for his God-fearing people. In 1820, Norman led the group to St. Anne's Bay on Cape Breton Island. The town grew and became a flourishing community of several thousand. Norman was magistrate, spiritual leader, and in charge of schooling, a stern but respected autocrat. In 1848, disaster struck. Crops failed and famine threatened. Norman's son wrote glowingly from Australia, urging Norman to join him. Norman and his followers built a ship, the Margaret. In 1851, with 140 passengers, they sailed for Australia. The Margaret stopped at Adelaide, then Melbourne, but Norman opted to sail on to New Zealand, where they settled at Waipu. More ships followed, bringing a further 750 people.
When the land was first they came, in Scotland long ago, the crofters first they lived lives, and bitter was their woe. Then the Reverend Norman MacLeod, he lifted up his head, with the help of God we'll find the ship, and I'll lead you forth, he said. And they came fast forth, where he never failed before, across the wildest lonely seas.
land of MacLeod, our connection is in the name and chorus. Our opening scenes show places in the Skye MacLeod lands, Loch Stunvegan and Sawdle, the River Hamara and Lochpool Teal. St Mary's, Kilmure in Dunvegan, is burial place of recent MacLeod chiefs. We see Chief John's and Dame Flora's graves. St Clement's, Rodal on Harris, is burial place of our 8th chief, Alistair Croddock. And the final scene is in the Eye Church on Lewis, burial place for the ancient chiefs of the MacLeods of Lewis. Some musical historians believe the song The Land of MacLeod, in its original Gaelic, dates back to the mid-1600s and the English Civil War. But the lyrics give mixed messages. The first verse seems to be a reference to soldiers being recruited to fight for the Jacobites in the 45, but not many from the land of MacLeod fought for the Prince. A few years later, Highlanders did join the British Army in large numbers, wore the red coat and took the King's shilling. To take the King's shilling meant to agree to serve in the King's army. The song was recorded by Robin Hall and Jimmy McGregor in 1977, and they believed it was about Highland recruits returning home after fighting abroad in the British Army to find the clearances underway, their old family homes burnt, and families dispersed. The final stanza did not exist in the original Gaelic version. Possibly the translator, Roddy McMillan, added it to reinforce the Highland clearance theme.
I will go, when the fighting is over, to the land of MacLeod, that I left to be a soldier. I will go, when the king's son came along, he called us all together, saying, brave Highland lads, won't ye fight for my father? I will go. I've a buckle on my belt, a sword in my scabbard, a red coat on my back, and a shilling in my pocket. I will go, I will go. Soldier, I will go, when we came down to the quay, the lassies were singing, but the tears began to fall when the bells started ringing. I will go, when we landed on the shore and saw the foreign heather, we knew that some would fall and remain there forever. I will go, I will go, when the fighting is over, to the land of MacLeod, that I left to be a soldier. I will go, when we came back to the glen, the winter was turning, our goods lay in the snow, and our houses were burning. I will go.
The tune is dedicated to Callum MacLeod, who single-handedly built a 1¾-mile road from Brockhill Castle on the Isle of Rasay to his home at Arnish. Scenes show the cairn dedicated to Callum, Brockhill Castle, the start of the road and up the first hill, through other hills and over the higher country to the north end at Arnish. Since the 1920s, when the population of North Rasay was over 100, the residents had been lobbying the Inverness Council to build a road to Arnish. The council kept putting it off as family after family moved away. Eventually, in the 1960s, when there was just a few people left, Callum decided the only way there would be a road was if he built it himself. He bought a small second-hand book on road making, assembled his tools, a wheelbarrow, a pick, an axe and a shovel, and with his lunchbox set off from his home at Arnish to the south end of the pathway, and there he started to build his road. Callum wore out 3 wheelbarrows, 6 picks, 6 shovels, 5 sledgehammers, 4 spades and a crowbar. Over 10 years he constructed a single lane road with passing places ready for tarmac surfacing. It took the council more than another decade to install surfacing. The tune was written by Donald Shaw of the band Kappa Kali and featured in the TV series The Blood Is Strong. The Skye Boat Song was written by Sir Harold Bolton to a tune collected by Annie MacLeod. It was first published in Songs of the North by Bolton and MacLeod in 1884. The song recalls the voyage in 1746 when Bonnie Prince Charlie, disguised as the servant woman of Flora MacDonald, escaped to the Isle of Skye. Scenes during our introduction show Flora MacDonald, the cairn commemorating her birthplace at Milton on South Uist, MacLeod's Maidens and Dunvegan Head, places they passed on the voyage, the Prince's Point, where they landed on Skye, Portree and McNab's Inn, now the Royal Hotel, where Flora and the Prince parted, finally Flora's grave on Skye. They left Rosnish on the Isle of Benbecula in the Outer Hebrides in a boat under sail and oars, bound for the Isle of Skye. The evening was clear when they left, but they had only gone a few miles when it all changed. The wind strengthened, the seas became rough, and it rained heavily. As the song says, loud the winds howl, loud the waves roar, thunderclaps rend the air. The lyrics then hark back to the Battle of Culloden, and at the end forecast that before long, Charlie will come again. The boat safely reached Mungstad on Skye's Trotnish Peninsula the following evening, but Bonnie Prince Charlie had many more adventures before he finally escaped to France. During our bagpipe segment, we will see scenes along Bonnie Prince Charlie's escape route across Skye after he parted from Flora. He was escorted by Captain Malcolm MacLeod of the Rasay family. Scenes include the Coolans, Glen Swickigan and Elgle. From Elgle, he went by boat to the Scottish mainland. Rona Cooper's MacLeods started on the Isle of Lewis. They emigrated to Nova Scotia in 1860, came to Waipu. She also has roots on the Isles of Rasay and Rona and is connected to Callum MacLeod of Callum's Road. Rona plays the guitar and whistle. Jeremy Cooper came to the Clan MacLeod through his best mate, Peter MacLeod. He reinforced his MacLeod connection by marrying Rona. Together, they have performed MacLeod music at MacLeod gatherings in Australia, New Zealand, and at Clan Parliament on Skye. Glenys MacLeod Saunders traces her MacLeods back to Trottinish on Skye. In the 1850s, they came to Australia and settled in central Victoria. Glenys moved to New Zealand 45 years ago. She leads a Scottish music group and attends the annual Scottish Fiddle Camp in Auckland. Elaine Little and Colleen Beattie are sisters and members of the Ukuleides of Levin Music Group. Their great-great-grandfather, Kenneth MacLeod, and his family came to Waipu from Nova Scotia in 1853. Gordon Lister's great-great-grandfather, Donald MacLeod, arrived in New Zealand in 1863 from Tongue in Scotland. The family produced official pipers for the Duke of Sutherland. Gordon is a bass drummer, snare drummer, and drum major with the Pipes and Drums of Palmerston North. Maureen Lister's mother came from Ochiltree in Scotland. Her father was from Belfast. She is interested in all things Scottish, including history and music. Maureen plays the bodhrum and the snare drum for the Pipes and Drums of Palmerston North. Colin Caddick plays the Highland pipes, the Irish pipes, low and small pipes, and the whistle, and is an accomplished vocalist. He has played for a number of pipe bands, including Auckland and the Celtic folk bands, Callanish and Fiddler's Bitches. Kevin Watson is one of New Zealand's leading guitarists. He has worked on recording sessions, radio and television, and toured with the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra. He has been a musical director for shows in Wellington and Hawke's Bay and a regular at Napier's annual jazz concert. We were fortunate to have the help of Paul Webster, a skilled and experienced sound engineer. His father inspired him to join the Scottish Society, and his love of sound engineering gave him a double reason to help with the MacLeod Music Project. Our final tune on the bagpipes is The Green Hills of Tyrol. It was transcribed by John MacLeod during the Crimean War from an 1829 Rossini opera. In the 1960s, it was made popular as The Scottish Soldier by Andy Stewart.